were just to look at market value of equity of banks and the book value of equity of banks. These are two statistics that are entering into economic models. People are not really agreeing on which one should enter those, but they diverged completely during the crisis. It's just an aggregate statistic, but it tells us a lot about like what's going on. I mean, if you just look at the book equity, it tells you that accounting values often mask risk exposures, and even realize the risk in a crisis. And maybe also market equity sometimes overreacts, but at the same time, they were in fact much earlier on catching on to what was going on in the banking sector than book equity was. I'm Juliane Begenau. I'm a assistant professor of finance at Stanford's Graduate School of Business. So my research is generally really focused on banks and banking and the measurement of risk in banking. There's a lot of methods in trying to figure out what's the risk of banking, and I believe the approach that I bring here is both novel and also applicable to particularly the question that our banks are facing and the type of risk that they are taking. What is often a concern is like that regulators and academics often are lagging behind what are the new risks that they are taking and spotting the risk. You see that a lot of times that the core reports, these are kind of the regulatory filings, often introduce new variables after the fact. So, which is very difficult in order like, for us, because that's kind of the data that we are using as academics in order to figure out what type of risk that they're taking. So one needs to have like kind of a fairly, in some sense, precise but a broad approach in order to figure out what are actually new risks and where they could evolve and where to zoom in on banks actually and what are the risks they're having. So it's a kind of a well-tested method. It's called kind of the replicating portfolio approach. A lot of financial management firms do that. That's what we teach also our MBA students, kind of whether how to value companies. Well, you're kind of figuring out what are the cash flows that these companies have and what is the underlying risk. And then you're trying to figure out what's my best alternative to these cash flows. Mm-hmm. And that allows us to get a sense of what is the risk of those cash flows. And that's in the same way as that's how I approach banks. Banks have, in a sense, I mean, they have a very complicated portfolio. What we are trying to do, what I'm trying to do, is kind of both to reduce the dimensionality of this complicated portfolio and to map it into something that is, again, that we can make sense of and understand risk exposure. For example, if you're thinking the banks, although complicated portfolio on one hand, but they do have a lot of securities, which are bonds, treasury bonds, and loans. And those can be mapped fairly easily into a credit market portfolio that has both the same term exposure, so the same interest rate risk exposure that banks have, and the same credit risk exposure. And you can verify that the cash flows of those both of those portfolios look very similar. And then from there, you can then deduce, well, the same risk exposure that this capital market portfolio, this replicating portfolio have, it's the same risk exposure that banks have. By comparing basically the cash flows of the banks and what the regulatory reports tell us, what is like the position, the amount of the position, how much interest rate exposure is there, we can kind of deduce what would be the best alternative capital market object that is a kind of a bond portfolio. And from there, we can reduce the risk. So other part of the equation is leverage, right? So anybody that works on credit knows banks have a lot of leverage, much more than other financial institutions. So even if the asset side doesn't look super risky, if you lever it up by a lot, even though like the loss is like 1%, but you lever 10 times, then it's like a 10% loss that could hit you. So that's always something to be worried about in the case of banks. I mean, if interest rates rise, and they do have some notable interest rate exposure, this will make the value of the portfolio decline. Regulators trying to keep tabs on a lot of sorts of risk, it's hard to predict ex ante what's going to be. So, I mean, I think we are, as an economist, we are more tend to be a doctor to diagnose what the illness was about and maybe to think about treatments and making some preventative measures. But it's really hard to anticipate who else is going to get sick and what will be the next illness that is going to afflict the banking sector. I think leverage is always a concern. I think a more general concern is to assess really the risk of banks. Because a lot of their data comes in terms of accounting values. For example, net interest margin is one of the key performance statistics of banking. It means like interest income on assets minus the interest expense on debt. This net interest margin has been very flat over time. And then it has been concluded that there is not a lot of interest rate or even credit risk exposure. Came in times when interest rate risk was high, in the 80s particularly, when we had these sudden interest rate spikes in the end of the 70s. And we had also credit exposure crises happened in the 2008-2009 crisis.